Good morning, everyone. Why don't we start off with a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we're just thankful that we can all be gathered here this morning, and we just pray as we take this time to just have what you have in store for us. I just pray that you'll settle our hearts. Allow us to put the, whatever's been going on this week aside, and just allow us to focus on you this morning. And I just pray that you will just guide us in everything we do here this morning, and help us to point the honor and glory to you, because you certainly deserve it, God. And I just pray now as we continue that we can just focus on you here this morning and hear from your word as well. In Jesus' name.
Good morning. Won't you please stand and join us in singing hymn number 107, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me.
We'll be providing sack lunches for people that go. You can look ahead for anything else that's coming up, but that's kind of it for what we're doing here in the short term. So we can look at our birthdays here. I don't know that we have any of the birthday people here, but 24th, which would be today, we have Penny Johnson. And then on the 25th is Olivia. Bryant's. And then on the 27th, we'll be on the lake, and we don't even have to ask her. It puts it right in there, 105 years old.
105.
I guess, you know, I just turned 50 yesterday, but I'm not even half her age yet. So I'm still there. How comes you are close to me? Because of yesterday. I was just the last week.
Last week.
Okay, is there any other birthdays we want to miss that aren't in there? I guess we can still sing happy birthday to these people. Maybe they'll be watching some of them. We have an anniversary this week, Mike and Pat Smith, on the 27th. Happened to see them, wish them a happy anniversary. Well, let's move on to our scripture reading this morning. I'm going to read Psalm 13. It's a pretty short little psalm here, but before we do that, let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just pray that you will bless your scripture as we read it and just open our hearts, our minds, to hear what you have to speak through your words here this morning. In Jesus' name. So again, I'm going to be reading from Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. My enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my face will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. You know, this psalm is a little, you know, starts off as kind of a downer, you know. You know, it's the psalmist here, it's the psalm of David, you know, crying out to God, you know, how long are you going to forget me, God? How long will you hide your face from me? You know, and I think a lot of times, you know, it's hard for us to process those kind of questions or admit to them, maybe. But, you know, here, you know, we see David struggling. And, you know, if you look at the history of David, certainly he struggled and had probably more problems in his life than a lot of us do. But, you know, we all have things that perhaps we question God. We wonder about, you know, why we're suffering a certain thing. Why do we have to go through this? And, you know, David had these same questions here. But I think, you know, the key parts of these are really the last two verses where he says, you know, no matter what's going on, I'm still going to put my trust in your unfailing love. My heart will rejoice in your salvation. I'll sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. So, you know, kind of wherever life finds us, we need to be able to get to the place of those last verses there and, you know, sing our praise to God. You know, just rejoice in what he has done for us. And, you know, one of the things that kind of brought my mind to this passage this week was, I don't know, maybe you haven't heard, but Rabbi Zacharias passed away this week. And, you know, I know he's one that has, you know, he was very into apologetics, and, you know, certainly there's a lot of different areas that he would talk about. Well, one of the things, you know, I know I've seen him speak about before was suffering and why is there suffering in this world. And certainly in his last few days, he, you know, underwent a lot of pain with the cancer that killed him. But yet, you know, you can go find his videos. That's the good thing about the technology we have today, that even though, you know, he's passed away from this life, we can still hear his messages. But, you know, he always just, to me, was a good one at just describing, you know, why there's still suffering on this earth. You know, why do we have to go through things? And so, Yeah, it just brought to mind anyway this week that, you know, we are living in a fallen world, and there's going to be pain, but, and, you know, at times we're going to have questions like David did here, but hopefully we can also respond as he did in this song. Okay, with that, we'll move to our praise and prayer time. I didn't see any particular requests back there. So I'll just pray for the ones we have here, and we can pray again for Darla's brother, Dick. We mentioned that last week. You know, he's suffering with dementia in the home, and so we can continue to pray for him. But let's take some time now and just pray to God. Heavenly Father, we just praise you for the many ways that you bless us in our lives. We do want to bring Dick before you this morning here as he continues to suffer with dementia and is, you know, with just the visiting policies and stuff from the COVID situation right now. You know, he's probably more lost and confused than ever, and Darla can't be there with him. And we just lift him up to you through this time. We pray that you can be his comfort through this time, and just guide Darla as well, and just, you know, when she is able to speak with him on the phone or whatever, we just pray that you'll guide her conversation, give her the words to speak to him, to lift up his spirits, and just for others who may be in isolation at this time, we just lift them to you as well, and we do just want to continue to pray for revival in our valley. We just pray that you will use these times to draw people to you, to open their hearts, to understand the truths of the gospel. We just pray that you will continue just to guide us as a church as we move on with a building project and just all that entails there and decisions that need to be made. We just pray that you will continue to guide those decisions, help us to make the right ones and to, you know, to get the building finished. We want to lift our missionaries to you. We just pray that, you know, again, it's kind of trying times for them. Some of them have, you know, gone out of the countries they were working in, and we just lift them up to you. We pray that they will be able to continue their ministry in some way, even through these times. And we just pray that you'll not let them get discouraged through this time. We lift up our nation to you, our leaders. We just pray that you give them wisdom. We pray that that you will just be their guide through, you know, whatever decisions come upon them. And we just, again, just pray for them and just that you will give them wisdom. We lift our military to you, the law enforcement. We just pray that you will keep them safe and help them to do their job effectively and in the way that you would have them to. We also just pray, you know, even though we haven't been doing Sunday school, we just pray for that ministry, the kids, as, you know, even now planning for Bible school this summer. We just pray that you'll make that to happen and that you'll provide the help that's needed there. And we just pray, you know, in everything we do here as a church, we want to give glory to you. We just pray that you'll give us wisdom as we move forward. And just, you know, for any prayers that remained unspoken here this morning, we offer them up to you. And again, we just pray that you'll give us a spirit of prayer in our lives. In Jesus' name.
Once again, please stand and join us in singing.
Thank you.
We introduced this song last week, All of Creation. And I wanted to read just quickly from Psalm 66. Listen to what God tells us. Make a joyful shout to God, all the earth. Sing out the honor of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your works. Through the greatness of your power, your enemies shall submit themselves to you. And all the earth will worship you and sing praises to you. They shall sing praises to your name. Let's do that this morning.
Yeah.
Somebody finally decided to say that God is essential. So we know He is. We never had doubt. Nobody had to tell us that. But we're going to continue by taking an offering. And Chuck, you and Lonnie are right there close. Why don't you come up and give me a hand, please? Chuck, could you come on up here and offer a prayer? Thank you,
Lonnie. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for all the gifts and all the blessings that you give us every single day. We thank you for watching over us and taking care of us, keeping us safe. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you give us. And that we just pray that you'll just accept this small amount of yours that we return to you, that you may that we may do more of your good and your light may shine brighter. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Thank you, Carolyn. We continue in the book of Galatians today. Third chapter, we're going to look at verses 6 through 9. You know, all the way through this book of Galatians, we have had this debate, I guess you'd say, this argument Paul is having with these Judaizers, these false teachers that have come out of Jerusalem and really are trying to corrupt the Christian religion. And they have even, you know, Paul even got into to Peter's face, if you will. Peter and Barnabas were kind of misled by these
false teachers. And so we continue this thought today of justification and salvation based only on faith, not on any works of man. But I got to thinking, and I just start off today for all of us to think a little bit about what Judaizers might look like in the church today. I mean, do we sometimes put too much stock in what we think a Christian should look like? How they should behave in church? There's just so many things we run into here. How they should dress. Do you hold your hands up in music? Do you not hold your hands up in music? I just think that we need to remember, we are all only saved by one thing.
Amen.
And that's God's grace through faith in His Son, Jesus Christ. So I think we need to apply this stuff, you know, as we go through. We need to all use it to kind of take a look at ourselves and don't just say, boy, those people were awful 2,000 years ago. You know, we can get tripped up on some of this stuff too. So just we need to consider it as we go through this book of Galatians. Now today, I appreciate Leon's opening again. Leon talked about one of the great Old Testament saints in King David. And I appreciated the fact that he pointed out that David was certainly not pure, that he struggled with sin. Today, in these verses of Galatians, Paul is going to lead us to another Old Testament saint, Abraham, but another man that struggled with sin. And we're going to talk about that a little bit today. Abraham is probably one of the most honored men in all of human history. He's, of course, the patriarch, and he is the father of the Hebrew people, but there are a few names in the world, again, that are revered to the point of Abraham. Consider that he is revered in three different faiths, in Judaism, in Islam, and in Christianity. And you'll find in several of Paul's letters that he looks to the life of Abraham as an example of a man who lived his faith. And we're going to see that today. Paul is going to use, in these verses, he's going to use Abraham as the best example of how humans can receive God's free gift of grace. Consider that Abraham lived 2,000 years before Jesus Christ was born. 4,000 years from the time that we're in right now. Yet, he received God's gift of righteousness, of justification by faith. Abraham believed God's promises. And one of those promises that he believed was the fulfillment of Messiah, the coming of Messiah. So he was saved by faith that God would do what he said he was going to do, even though it took 2,000 years before it occurred. He was looking forward to the coming Messiah. We're sitting here today and we're looking back to the one that's come, and we are saved by faith in that Son of God. So Galatians 3, beginning in verse 6, and as always, before we go to the scripture, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just lift this time up to you right now, Lord. I just pray that you would set me aside completely, Father, and just speak through me. I pray that through your Holy Spirit, you would just reveal the truths of the words that we read today, Father. And we just thank you that you have brought them forward through all these years, that we can use them now as a guide to our life. And Father, I just pray for each and every one of us that we would just receive strength and courage from your word today. And I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Verse 6, even so, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Therefore, be sure that it is those who are of faith who are sons of Abraham. The scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all nations will be blessed in you. So then those who are of faith are blessed with Abraham the believer. Now these Judaizers, you know, as we've gone through this this book of Galatians, and certainly if you're familiar with the book of Acts, these Judaizers look to the Old Testament and especially to the teachings of Moses. But Paul is going to step back even further. 500 years before Moses lived, Paul's going to step back to the time of Abraham. Abraham lived somewhere around 2100 BC to 1900 BC. Moses about 1526 to 1406, somewhere in there. And Paul says here in verse 1, even so Abraham. In today's parlance, he might say, check out Abraham. Paul seems to be asking, how did the father of the Jewish people become justified? And the answer was simple. He refers to Genesis 15, verse 6, where it is declared, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Abraham's faith that God would do what he had promised to do was accepted by God as righteousness. And so this patriarch was justified. And bear in mind, because circumcision is one of the arguments that these Judaizers have had, you see it in the book of Acts, you see it here in Galatians, that to really be a Christian, you ever heard anybody say that? To really be a Christian, whatever, fill in the blanks, that these folks are saying you need to be circumcised. And so you can just see that Paul is saying, look, 500 years before Moses ever gave us the law, and certainly a lot of years before Abraham himself was circumcised, that he was made righteous in God because of his faith in God. Now, these false teachers, I'm sure they would have looked at Abraham as proof that circumcision was necessary. But consider this. If you go back to Genesis 12, there you'll find the beginnings of this story of the patriarch Abraham. And God said in Genesis 12, verses 2 and 3, he tells Abraham to leave his home. His home was in Ur, is in Chaldea, and he tells him to leave. And he says there in verses 2 and 3 of chapter 12, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great. So you shall be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and the ones who curse you I will curse. And then listen to this final sentence. And in you, all families of the earth will be blessed. All families of the earth, not just the Jewish nation, but all families of the earth will be blessed. Now, much later than this, you know, probably 25 years later than these verses, we go to Genesis 17, and there God told Abraham that he and his descendants, in other words, the Hebrews, the Jews, were to be circumcised. Now, this procedure was quite simply, it was a sign of God's covenant with the Hebrew people and a reminder of the need for spiritual cleansing from sin. In verse 17, Genesis 17, verse 10, we read, this is my covenant, which you shall keep between me and you and your descendants after you. Every male among you shall be circumcised. Again, circumcision was symbolic. It was symbolic of the need to cut sin out of your life, out of your heart. But you can almost see that putting these two accounts together, Genesis 12 and Genesis 17, the false teachers would argue, isn't it obvious that if the rest of the world, that is the Gentile world, are to share in the promised blessings of Abraham, and God obviously promised that we would, they must first take the sign that marks God's people, the Jews. If all the nations of the earth will be blessed in Abraham, they will have to become like Abraham and be circumcised. These folks would argue that point. But Paul again says, folks, Genesis 15, 6, don't you know that even so Abraham believed God before he was ever circumcised? He believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And by doing so, Paul points out that these folks have conveniently chosen to ignore the fact that the scripture precisely ascribes righteousness to Abraham's life by faith, and that God had commanded that he and the Hebrews that follow would be circumcised many, many years later. You know, I'm going to take a little detour here, but I think it ties into these verses, and I think it's important for us to consider. Abraham's life gives us a lot of examples for all of us now, 4,000 years later. So I want to take just a little time this morning and talk about just part of it. First off, in these verses that we're looking at today, I want you to consider what a shock it must have been to these Jews to hear Paul say, for instance, in verse 7, that it is those who are of faith who are sons of Abraham. Not ethnicity, but faith. And then he goes on to rub it in a little bit in verse 9. He says, so then, those who are of faith are blessed with Abraham, the believer. That must not have sat well with those folks. They put a lot of pride, a lot of stock, even to the point of believing it provided for their salvation, simply because they were biologically descendant of Abraham. But Paul's telling them that when we believe in God, when we put our faith in God as Abraham did, it will be credited to us also as righteousness. As we're told elsewhere in Scripture, we become spiritual children of Abraham. And folks, just as a note, if you remember back to what God said to Abraham in chapter 12 of Genesis, this is how the whole world is blessed. This is how the whole world is blessed through Abraham, and we'll talk about that a little more in just a minute. Now, tying back into what Leon said this morning, as we read many of these Old Testament stories, we read about these Old Testament saints such as Abraham, we make the mistake of seeing these folks as some kind of super saint. Someone who possessed such a super faith that it is beyond our ability to ever obtain. Folks, Abraham, King David, you can go through the list. They were all humans, period. They were prone to the same emotions and the same weaknesses as you are. And we can give a lot of examples. I'll just go to one. And that was Abraham's adultery with Hagar. And it was adultery. I know none of you men are wondering about this, but if your wife ever comes to you and says, I have a lady that cleans house and you could take her in and sleep with her if you want to, that's still your sin. Perhaps your wife put the idea in your head, but it is still sin. And that's what we have here in the story of Abraham. And the product of that adultery was Ishmael. And 4,000 years later, the world is having a huge struggle, aren't we? Because of that adultery. So, yes, Abraham was a weak, emotionally prone human being, just like each and every one of us. You know, one Bible scholar, though, has kind of put it this way, thinking about us trying to compare ourselves to some of these Old Testament saints, particularly Abraham. He said, if we compare our faith with Abraham's and we try to work up a super faith within us, we'll become spiritual hypochondriacs. We'll always be going about taking our spiritual temperature and feeling our spiritual pulse and always thinking that we are sickly and weak, when the truth is, we're just humans. Abraham was a weak and a faltering human being just like us. But it was his faith that credited him as righteousness. It was not his works. And we're spiritual descendants of his. It is an absolute truth, folks. All of us. Every human that's ever lived, Abraham, King David, Joseph, whoever you want to name, we are all spiritually inadequate. But God is more than adequate. We struggle with our faith, and he is always faithful. He will keep every promise that he has ever made. Simply, we are weak, and so is our faith, but he's strong. When we're too weak to go, and he picks us up, and he carries us in his arms. Understand that the genuineness of our faith is not based on our feelings, because our feelings will fail us. There will be times when we don't feel very strong in our faith, but God's love for us is consistent and it never fails. When we can't sleep at night because of our doubts, because of our fears, if we will simply turn those doubts and fears over to the one who knows the beginning from the end, he'll carry us through. You know, the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation, God's word speaks of only one way to salvation, and that way is through faith. We cannot work our way to God. Salvation is not something we earn. It is something we can only receive as a free and undeserved gift. We're accepted by God on the basis of faith alone. This same Apostle Paul, in writing to the Ephesians in chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, put it this way. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. We find the same faith principle that Paul speaks of here in the book of Galatians, clear back in the pages of Genesis. Abraham believed the Lord, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Abraham could never earn God's favor by works. He couldn't earn it by circumcision, rites, or traditions. He could only receive it the same way we do, by faith. Now note, this affirmation of God of Abraham here in Genesis 15, if you go back and you read the whole story, and you might want to do that after church today, if you read the whole thing in context, you're going to find out that this doesn't come after some great work that Abraham performed in his life. Actually, it comes at a time of terrible doubting and fear on Abraham's part, at a time when Abraham was hanging on to his faith by a thread. And it was at this time of his fear and doubt that God reaffirmed his promise, and Abraham's faith was strengthened. Abraham believed God regarding his promise of a coming son. Can you imagine? You're 99 years old, your wife's 89, and God says, when I come back by this time next year, you're going to have a son. You know, we don't get the whole story in the Bible, but this is one time I just kind of picture Abraham saying, say what? 99 years old. And poor Sarah, 89 years old. God's promise. Nothing. Small thing for God. Nothing is too big for God. But 2,000 years ago, and 2,000 years after God made this promise to Abraham, we see the complete fulfillment of that promise. And it was in a son, but it wasn't Isaac. It wasn't the Bible, although Isaac was the son of promise. But as far as human ancestry goes, it's the incarnation of Jesus Christ. That is the ultimate promised son. And for all of these centuries, since Jesus appeared, God has called us to believe that in this Son who has already come. And folks, if we'll cease trying to please God with our works and start living in absolute dependence on this living Son of God, then our faith also will be credited to us as righteousness. And you know, we see periods in Abraham's life. It wasn't just one event in Abraham's life that's credited to him as righteousness. It wasn't just one event where he lived his life by faith. And the same is true for us. So we shouldn't believe that this one-time event of placing our faith in Jesus Christ is the end of it all. The moment you receive him as faith, as your Lord, you're just beginning a very exciting adventure. just as Abraham began a life of adventure the moment he set forth from Ur. Like Abraham, when we struggle with fear and doubt, we must turn those fears and those doubts, turn our entire life, folks, over to Almighty God, trusting that His promises will shield us, that His promises will provide for us great reward. And I have one last thought here. I think we have to be careful as Christians when we read stories like we've read in Galatians here, when we read stories in the Gospels about the Jews and what they did, and about the fact that, for the most part, they rejected Jesus Christ. And I think we have to be careful that because God's chosen people, the Jews, did for the most part reject the Lord, that in somehow God has rejected them. The Apostle Paul declares forcefully in Romans 11. Romans 11 in verses 1 and 2, he says this about the Jewish nation. And I say then, has God rejected His people? Has He? May it never be. Then he repeats the declaration. God has not rejected His people whom He foreknew. God still has marvelous plans for the Jews as His people. But also understand this, at no time in history, either prior to God's calling of the Jewish nation, before or after, has any person been brought into a saving relationship with God other than by the means of faith. When Gentiles are saved, we're saved as Gentiles. When Jews are saved, they're saved as Jews. But no one from either group is saved or not saved due to their ethnicity. Those who are saved because of faith. Those who are lost because of unbelief. The Gentile has absolutely no advantage in becoming a Jew before he becomes a Christian. In fact, for Jew or Gentile, to expect salvation because of any rite, any tradition, or any works, that person nullifies the grace of God. And as we were told back in Galatians 2, verse 21, that person is saying that Christ died needlessly. But He didn't, did He? He died for me. I hope you've accepted Him as your Lord and Savior. And I hope you're sure of the fact that you have. If you haven't, I would encourage you to do so today. I would encourage you to continue to pray for revival in our community, in our country, in our world. I think what an opportunity we have right now. There is a tremendous amount of fear out there in the world. And the basis, if you get right down to it, and people are honest, the root of fear is death. And this coronavirus has cost a lot of that. You know what the numbers are. Jesus Christ dealt with death. He dealt with it. And if we are followers of His, we have no need to fear it either. Continue to pray for someone or family or a group that you may have selected, and if not, please do so and continue to pray for them. Heavenly Father, as we close today, I just thank You for each person that is here with us physically today. I thank You for those that will view this via the internet, Father. I just thank You for the faithfulness that we see in this fellowship. I thank You for their willingness, Father, to go out there, to be Your soldiers, Father, to be witnesses of You, to live their life for You. And I just pray that You would strengthen and encourage us as You have promised to do in Your word, Lord. And I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Leon, when we're done here, if you close us in word of prayer.
Please stand. Join us in singing hymn number 105. grace greater than our sin.
Heavenly Father, we do thank you this morning for that grace, and we do thank you that it's greater than all our sin, that our righteousness comes not from what we do, but for what Jesus did for us on the cross. And help us never to forget that. Help us to live our lives accordingly, and to let you be Lord, to let you be the director of our lives. And we just pray that you'll do that as we go out this week. Just fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit. Help us to shine your love out to those who come across our paths this week, and we just pray that you will protect us, keep us safe, and just keep us with our eyes fixed on you. In Jesus' name, amen.